Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Rise and Fall of the East, How Exams, Autocracy, Stability, and Technology Brought China's Success, and Why They Might Lead to Its Decline, by Yasheng Huang, PhD. Narrated by Rebecca Lam. Publisher's Note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. For a few days in November 2022, triggered by a deadly fire in Urumqi, Xinjiang, hundreds or thousands of protesters in Shanghai, Beijing, and other cities took to the street and university campuses to demonstrate against the government's draconian zero-COVID controls. A few in the crowd shouted, and were echoed by others, "Step down, Xi Jinping. Step down, the Communist Party." It was an incredibly brave act of defiance against a leader who had just consolidated power a month earlier at the 20th Party Congress. Some in the Western press quickly jumped on the narrative that this was potentially a game changer for the regime. In some ways, it was. Since 1989, protests in China have been scattered, localized, and issue-specific. For a protest that was nationwide in scale and had an explicit anti-regime tone, this was an extraordinary development. That said, the COVID protest is a protest, not, or not yet at the time of this writing, a movement. The size of the protests was at the most in the thousands, compared with the millions who protested in 1989. Let's stack the size of the COVID protest against the grievance they were protesting against. Effectively, an incarceration of hundreds of millions of people in their homes and in field hospitals. The lockdowns led to suicides, miscarriages, fires, starvation, and many other horrifying abominations. And yet, in a country of 1.4 billion people, just a few thousand came out to the street. The backlash is significant because it happened at all, not because of the size of its threat. To compare, at the time of China's COVID protests, millions of people in Iran demonstrated for weeks on end. Their grievance, the death of one woman in the hands of the country's morality police. It was a COVID protest, not a COVID spring, for a good reason. The Chinese state is incredibly strong. For many years, I struggled to come up with a coherent explanation for the power, reach, and discretion of the Chinese state. Certainly coercion and ideological indoctrination are at work, and probably a fair amount of societal consent as well. Also, over the past four decades, the strong growth of the Chinese GDP and the alleviation of poverty have earned the Chinese state a healthy amount of performative legitimacy. That has undoubtedly added some staying power to the CCP. But there has to be more. Although the previous explanations may be individually and situationally valid, they don't give us a holistic explanatory framework. Performative legitimacy may explain the reform era, but how do we explain the Great Leap Forward and the Cultural Revolution? Didn't these catastrophes generate a non-trivial dose of performative illegitimacy? And we have not mentioned the longevity of Imperial China. My search for an explanation has been guided by two principles. One is parsimony. A variable is preferred over another one if it accommodates more of the questions or situations involved, or if it underscores those variables often proposed as causes. The other principle is proximity. That is, the closer the variable is to the explanatory vicinity of the empirical phenomenon under scrutiny, the better. This is how I arrived at the first component of the East formulation, examination. If I am to name just one difference between China and other civilizations, I would say Keju, the civil service examination first implemented during the Sui dynasty, which was in power from 581 to 618. Keju is China's blessing, but also its curse in more ways than one. I use this perspective to unlock and to make sense of the other three East components: autocracy, stability, and technology. Keju had deep penetration both cross-sectionally in society and across time and history. It was all-encompassing, laying claim to enormous investments in time and effort by a significant proportion of the Chinese population. It was an incubator of values, norms, and ideas, and so influenced the ideology and epistemology that lay at the foundation of Chinese minds. It was a state institution designed to augment the power and the capabilities of the state. Directly, the state monopolized the very best human capital. Indirectly, the state deprived society access to talent and preempted organized religion, commerce, and intelligentsia. The Chinese state in history and today is an imprinted version of this Keju system. The Chinese state is strong because it reigns without a society. Society here means a society that is organized, has its own identity, and is considered separately legitimate from the state. Keju may not be the only cause, but it is a significant cause in decimating or preempting collective action, the essential feature of a civil society. Keju was fiercely competitive. It vaulted triumphs achieved in small and isolated examination cells, while it harshly punished collaboration, otherwise known as cheating in a Keju context. Think of the vibrantly individualistic Chinese entrepreneurs on the one hand, and their collective powerlessness vis-a-vis the CCP on the other. Think of the lockdown order in Shanghai lasting for several months. Even if a fraction of the 25 million Shanghainese acted in concert, either overtly or tacitly, in resistance, the state would be powerless no matter the size of its police force. In my mind, these are some intriguing conjectures. Others may say that they are fanciful. There may be criticisms of, for example, my broad topical coverage. East here is not geography. It is the four topics I explore. And I go back and forth between history and today. The book is admittedly broad and self-consciously ambitious. The usual academic format is to drill into one topic in great depth. My view is that books give us a way to tackle big topics that we are no longer able to take on in refereed journals. Very specialized and technical papers have their rightful places. But one casualty of increasing specialization and the extraordinarily high and highly varied hurdles to publication in academic journals is suboptimal supply of big ideas. Books are one of the few ways to go big. I leave it to the listeners to judge whether I have succeeded. My intention is to propose a few scaffolding ideas by which we make sense of some historical and contemporary facts and events. And there are big topics in front of us. The COVID protest is, I believe, a game changer in the sense that hundreds of millions of people shared a deeply felt experience. The tenacity of imperial regimes and of the CCP derived in no small measure an ability to compartmentalize and isolate people and preempt collective actions. Will the COVID protests presage a turning point? And what will be the long-term consequences, especially amid the rising anxiety and fear in Chinese society? At the time of this writing, some of the issues and situations are still fluid and evolving, and I may get them wrong, or I may not have pinned down all the precise channels and mechanisms. I hope that this book may open further debates and discussions. Introduction. Unpacking the East formulation. When your scope for action is greatest, the knowledge on which you can base this action is always at a minimum. When your knowledge is greatest, the scope for action has often disappeared. Henry Kissinger, 1970. The Qin Dynasty, 221 to 207 BCE, China's first dynasty, is the defining and consequential period of Chinese political development. all the imperial progenies of the Qin, as well as their republican successors, the nationalist government, and then the People's Republic of China, or PRC, carried on many of the salient features of the Qin dynasty, such as its unitary autocracy, top-down rule, impersonal nature, meritocracy, and repressiveness. The Qin dynasty gave birth to political China. There are, however, two unusual features about that dynasty. One is that for a dynasty with such a long shadow on Chinese polity, it was extraordinarily short, lasting for only 14 years, the shortest of all major dynasties. The other is that the seemingly mighty Qin, which built the Great Wall and terracotta soldiers, standardized measurements and roads, and created a national bureaucracy, was toppled by nothing more than a ragtag gang of peasants turned rebels, armed with wooden sticks. This is known as the Dazi Xiang Uprising. The storyline is familiar to all school-age children in China. In 209 BCE, Chen Sheng, Wu Guang, and 900 conscripts were ordered to garrison in Yuyang, near present-day Beijing. Severe flooding delayed their journey, but under Qin law, conscripts who failed to reach their destination on time would be executed. This pushed Chen and Wu into a corner. If they were to continue, they would surely die upon arrival. If they were to rebel, they had a fighting chance to be alive. Chen and Wu rebelled. This was the first peasant rebellion in Chinese history, setting a precedent for many subsequent rebellions. Chinese history textbooks use this episode to teach students about the harshness of Qin rule. The real lessons, however, are much deeper. One lesson is about incentives. From the earlier account, one can easily see that the flaw in the poor design of Qin rule led to the unintended consequence of encouraging rebellion. But this interpretation sits uncomfortably with our knowledge about the Qin. The Qin espoused legalism, a doctrine that prized incentives above all else. The other dynasties may have made this incentive error, but probably not the Qin. A Chinese writer provides what I think is a far more convincing explanation. In his book, The Elegy of the Qin, Zhu Zhuofeng speculates that the conscript destination rule was designed for the smaller Qin kingdom, the predecessor to the Qin dynasty. The Qin kingdom unified China in 221 BCE by defeating and amalgamating six other kingdoms. It was small, only 1 million square kilometers, compared with the later Qin dynasty, which was three times as large. In the Qin kingdom, the conscript destination rule could be realistically met, but not in the larger Qin empire. Figure I.1, included in the print and ebook formats of this book, shows the Qin kingdom in the top panel and the Qin empire in the bottom panel. In terms of both the altitude and latitude dimensions, the Qin empire was more expansive than the Qin kingdom. The larger size of the Qin Empire increased the heterogeneity of conditions. A small region is more homogeneous in topographical, climate, and environmental conditions. The Qin Kingdom was located in the arid northwest region of China, where there were low variances in meteorological conditions. The Qin Empire encompassed far more diverse settings. Its territory stretched from the southeast to the north. Flooding might not have been a frequent occurrence in the arid North China, but it was common in Southeast China. Dazixiang and Yuyang are in two different climate zones, and both places are situated outside of the original Qin kingdom. The decision makers who created the time-bound rule probably had no idea about these heterogeneities on the ground, and they failed to take into account the added complexities of a larger empire. The tensions between homogeneity and heterogeneity, I also call them scale and scope, are an underlying theme in Chinese history and today. What the Dazi Xiang Uprising shows is that you ignore the complexities of scale and scope at your own peril. The Chinese rulers have resolved these tensions, often in favor of homogeneity. In ideology, one idea, Confucianism or communism, gained at the expense of other ideas. In politics, one ruler, an emperor or a general secretary of the Chinese Communist Party, or CCP, dominated other centers of power. In bureaucracy, one type of human capital, Confucian mandarins or technocrats, edged out other types of human capital. As China homogenized, it also became larger. The Han Dynasty, 202 BCE to 220 CE, covered an area of 6 million square kilometers. The figures are estimates and refer to the size of the dynasties at their peak. The Tang Dynasty, 618 to 907, doubled it to about 12 million square kilometers. In the Song Dynasty, 960 to 1279, the size of China shrank to only 2.8 million square kilometers, but thereafter, China began an expansion spree. At its height during the Yuan Dynasty, 1271 to 1368, China occupied an area of some 34 million square kilometers, much bigger than Russia at 17 million square kilometers, the largest territorial country on Earth today. The Ming, 1368 to 1644, and the Qing, 1644 to 1911, dynasties stood at 10 and 13 million square kilometers, respectively. The People's Republic of China, or PRC, occupies an area of 9.6 million square kilometers. For comparison, the United States spans 9.1 million square kilometers. Along with this increase in the size of its territory, China also scaled up its bureaucracy. During the Tang Dynasty, bureaucrats comprised 0.02% of the population. This figure rose to 0.06% during the Southern Song Dynasty, 1127 to 1279, and 0.18% during the Ming Dynasty. For the Qing, China's last dynasty, the available estimates are extremely varied and less reliable. The PRC took the size of the bureaucracy to another level altogether. In 1982, the number of officials was 0.08% of the population, comparable to the Song, but this is based on a narrow definition of the state. A broader definition would encompass the rank-and-file CCP members who often perform governmental functions upon instructions from the CCP. Today, the CCP stands at 96 million strong, or 6.6% of the population. The later dynasties are also very durable. The Yuan had a short lifespan, lasting only 97 years, but the Tang, 289 years, the Song, 319 years, the Ming, 275 years, and the Qing, 266 years, all enjoyed impressive longevity. The Han Dynasty is believed to have been the longest-lasting dynasty in China, lasting 414 years, and roughly comparable to the duration of the partially contemporaneous Roman Republic, 509 BCE to 27 BCE. But this comparison is debatable. The Han can be thought of as comprising two distinct dynasties, the Western Han, 206 BCE to 9 BCE, 214 years in duration, and the Eastern Han, 25 to 220, 195 years in duration. The founder of the Eastern Han, Liu Xiu, was a descendant of the imperial clan of the Western Han Dynasty, but he was not in the direct line of succession. His ancestors had been generations of landlords in the provinces. It took Liu Xiu some 10 years to vanquish 11 other claimants to the throne, a reenactment of a new dynastic creation. If we view the Western and Eastern Hans as sufficiently distinct from each other, dynastic longevity emerges later. Now, let's turn to the PRC. It will be a while before it catches up with the 319 years of the Song Dynasty, but its longevity is still impressive. consider the following attributes of the PRC. It is one of the only five manifestly communist countries still remaining in the world. It has withstood catastrophic upheavals, such as the Great Leap Forward, the Cultural Revolution, and the 1989 Tiananmen crackdown. It has survived and even prospered from many crises that have toppled lesser regimes, such as Indonesia in 1998. Some of these crises originated from external sources. Others were on account of the culpability of the Chinese leadership. These include the 1998 Asian financial crisis, the 2008 Great Recession, the 2015 stock market crash, the 2003 SARS epidemic, the 2008 melamine scandal, and many days of air apocalypse in major Chinese cities, and the COVID-19 pandemic. It has been able to implement both economic and political shock therapies with apparent impunity. The draconian one-child policy, 1980 to 2015, the massive layoffs of as many as 30 to 50 million workers in state-owned enterprises, or SOEs, in the 1990s, the extraction of agricultural surpluses, both during the Mao era and far less well-known during the 1990s, control of the spread of COVID-19, zero COVID lockdowns of multiple cities between 2020 and 2022, a massive purge of political and economic elites on charges of corruption under Xi Jinping, and the abolition of the two-term limit for the presidency in 2018. It has survived the supposedly liberalizing effects of a growing middle class and private sector, globalization, and the rising living standard, defying the expectation that economic development would lead to democratization of the country. On October 1, 2023, China will celebrate the 74th anniversary of the founding of the People's Republic, superseding the longevity of the world's first communist country, the Soviet Union. That, of course, presupposes that the CCP does not collapse before then, fulfilling the predictions of a long line of Western observers, most famously Gordon Chang. His book, The Coming Collapse of China, was published in 2001. It seems more than 20 years on that coming is a relative term. Chang follows venerable footsteps in misjudging the staying power of a Chinese regime. In the 1850s, Marx forecast an imminent collapse of the Qing dynasty. Instead, laboring under enormous pressures from popular rebellions and foreign invasions, the Qing muddled on for another 60 years, outliving Marx himself. Hindsight is 20/20, and world politics is complicated enough that we hesitate to judge forecasters who get it wrong. But the upending by both Imperial China and its communist successor of the forecasts of their lifespan is worth noting, because it has happened so frequently and so repeatedly. More knowledgeable China hands do not rush out predictions about the demise of China. On Imperial China, Eric Jones remarks, China's uniqueness lay in retaining an empire and a culture for an immense span of time. Political scientist Andrew Nathan noted that the authoritarian resilience of China in the aftermath of the Tiananmen crackdown, contradicting the view held by many that Tiananmen dealt a fatal blow to the legitimacy of the CCP. In the early 1990s, analysts began counting the actuarial table of Deng Xiaoping, predicting that his death would precede the death of the regime itself. Deng died in 1997. I participated in this debate and happily ended up on the correct side of history. In 1995, publishing in Foreign Policy, Why China Will Not Collapse, I argued that after the death of Deng, China would not revert to the chaos of 1976. The reasons I listed were the greater economic integration among Chinese regions as a result of economic growth and the rise of nationalism in the CCP's framing of its ruling ideology. these two observations have stood the test of history well. The PRC under Mao experienced bouts of power struggles. During the reform era, since 1978, the power struggles have waned considerably. There have been large-scale popular protests, notably the demonstrations in 1989. But by and large, these popular rebellions have been brought under control without substantial damage to the overall architecture of the Chinese state. CCP membership rose in the years following the Tiananmen crackdown, along with tax revenue, the economy, and the material welfare of Chinese citizens. Meanwhile, the political system has become noticeably more authoritarian over time. The return to a form of a personality cult and a one-man dictatorship under Xi Jinping is so far out of the norm that few China scholars saw it coming. Many, myself included, predicted persistence back in 2012. Chinese autocracy seems stickier than autocracies elsewhere. Recall the spark that lit up what eventually became the Arab Spring. The catalyst was an act of self-immolation by a Tunisian street vendor, a protest against the confiscation of his assets by a municipal official. By contrast, street vendors in China are routinely harassed, beaten, and have their assets confiscated, and China's urbanization projects have led to numerous evictions of property owners. None has fazed the CCP. The 2022 COVID protests, a potential threat, to be sure, is unlikely to derail the CCP on its own, without significant fissures within the top leadership and significant economic hardship. My book grapples with this big question of the staying power of the Chinese political system and other related questions in their historical and contemporary contexts, and puzzles abound. How has China managed to achieve a larger size and more regime durability over time? What are the tools and instruments used to achieve this outcome? Another big question relates to the rise and fall of Chinese technologies and the relationships between political and technological developments. How has the CCP, one of the world's fiercest autocracies that stifles free speech and inquiries, managed to make advances in science and technology, and in ways that eluded the Soviet Union and its own imperial former self? These advances are achieved on the back of vibrant entrepreneurship and commercial applications. They are not lonely ideas. I want to probe what holds together the CCP, a mammoth organization of 96 million members, bigger than many countries, and how the CCP empowers enough individual agency to enable growth, but not enough to generate a systemic breakdown. The last part of the book is future-oriented. I explain the path to Xi Jinping and explore the broader implications of Xi's momentous reversion to extreme autocracy. In the rest of this introduction, I will present a framework illuminated by the Dazhexiang uprising. A nation often struggles between scale and scope, and successful ones get the balance between them right. I will frame the four topics of this book: examination, autocracy, stability, and technology, in terms of how these tensions are resolved. I conclude the introduction with an outline of the book to help a listener navigate the concepts, factual narratives, and development of ideas presented in this book. Balancing scale and scope. A large nation is both blessed and cursed. In their book, The Size of Nations, Alberto Alesina and Enrico Spolaore explain many of the tensions and trade-offs between the scale of a nation and its scope. A large scale can result in savings in the form of scale economies, but a large scope can sow discord and incoherence. The two economists recommend identifying an optimal zone between these two opposing forces to maximize the benefits of both scale and scope. Easier said than done. Let me illustrate by contrasting two historical polities, the Roman system of government and Imperial China. From the founding of the Republic in 509 BCE to the deposing of the last Roman emperor in 476, the Roman system of government is comparable in length to that of monarchical China, 221 BCE to 1911 CE. But it is not a perfect comparison on two counts. One is that the Roman Empire was preceded by the Roman Republic, 509 BCE to 27 BCE, and the transition in the regime type under the Roman Empire, 27 BCE to 476 CE, contrasted the regime immutability of Imperial China, not to mention the era of Communist China. The monarchical phase of the Roman system is only a fraction of the duration of monarchical China. The other difference is that the Roman Empire was split into Western and Eastern halves. The empire was already fractured before 476, when Europe escaped from Rome. This is an explicit acknowledgement that the empire had trouble scaling itself, and it was too big to be run as a single administrative unit, having to settle for a compromise between scale and scope. Not only that, after the fall of Roman Empire, there were multiple attempts by ambitious rulers and military commanders to reunify Europe in the image of Roman Empire. They all failed. Imperial China occasionally fell into disunity, but the disunity was de facto, never de jure, and in the 6th century, China reconstituted itself as a unified country, and it has never looked back. It then embarked on an expansion spree and scaled itself both spatially and temporally. Today, China under the CCP is very much a continuation of its imperial former self, tyrannical, unified, and durable against all odds. There are a myriad of differences between the Roman Empire and Imperial China, but let me single out one factor for emphasis. Imperial China invented a tool that enabled it to scale by reducing its scope. That tool is the first letter in our East formulation. Examination, civil service examination to be exact, which was invented in 587. The Roman Empire never invented a scaling tool as powerful as China's civil service examination, and the fierce, resilient heterogeneities derailed all the unifying campaigns. As a collection of sovereign states, Europe today is a legacy of that scaling failure. This is not to say that Europe could not scale. It scaled outward through imperialistic expansions, and its powerful corporations scaled their operations through market and private initiatives. But, as an approximation of a single political unit, Europe successfully scaled only after it invented a scaling instrument. Democracy. The official website of the European Union, or EU, proclaims, "The EU supports democratization and fundamental freedoms in partner countries by encouraging broad participation in political decision-making and local ownership of sectors that are key to sustainable development." All the members of the EU are democracies. This is an eligibility requirement for joining the EU. Democracy and autocracy resolve conflicts between scale and scope in fundamentally different ways. Autocracy suppresses scope through coercion, information controls, ideological indoctrination, and value incubation. Democracy preserves scope, but not scope on all issues. Democracy converges ideas, values, and state actions on just a few things, such as sanctity of elections, rights, and rule of law. The EU does not allow any heterogeneities on regime type. They all have to be democracies. The ingeniousness of the democracy is that it restricts scope on a few dimensions, so that scope on other dimensions, such as political, religious, and sexual orientations, can be preserved and can flourish. For democracy, getting scale and scope right involves more than a balancing act. It entails an ironclad consensus on a few key foundational issues. Autocracy, by contrast, treats scale and scope as diametrically opposing values. More than any other autocracies in the world, the Chinese autocracy has vaulted scale at the sharpest expense of the scope. Its absolute insistence on convergence, conformity, and uniformity is reinforced by the communist ideology, but it is also deeply embedded in its history and tradition. This is the central theme of this book. This book is admittedly and uncomfortably broad. It spans four big topics, the East formulation in the title of the book. To make the discussion analytically tractable, I will use two simple concepts, scale and scope, as a scaffold to frame the discussion. In my telling, each component of the East formulation resolves or is affected by the tensions between the scale and the scope conditions of China. Tensions between scale and scope. The dictionary definition of scale is the relative size or extent of something. It comprises two concepts, size and size of a particular dimension. Canada is a sizable country in terms of its geographic area. At about 10 million square kilometers, it is the world's second largest country and about 4% larger than China. But in terms of population, it is a dwarf, with only 38 million people. One Chinese city, Chongqing, has 32 million people. Size can refer to a physical dimension, the size of the territory and/or the size of the population of a country. My main interest, however, is not using the term to refer to a physical condition, an immutable situation, or a natural state of affairs, but using it in a way that denotes action and agency. In the example I provided earlier, in which the China of the Han at 6 million square kilometers grew to be the China of the Qing at 13 million square kilometers, my interest is to understand that process of expansion, rather than the static physical size of China during the Han and Qing dynasties. I deploy the term in its political dimension, the size and homogeneity of bureaucracy, the uniformity of ideology, and/or the magnitude of intangibles, such as the political commitments of the state. The dictionary definition of scope emphasizes a range of motions, of activities, of thoughts, or of operations. Scope comprises multiple dimensions and denotes heterogeneity, which is how the word is used in economics. Economy of scope refers to the cost savings from utilizing common inputs in the production of two or more distinct goods. By contrast, economy of scale refers to the cost savings from producing a large quantity of one good. Unless otherwise noted, I use scale and scope as relative dimensions. A scale expansion means an expansion relative to scope, rather than necessarily an absolute increase of scale. An increase of scale can increase that ratio, but so does a decrease of scope when holding scale constant. Polities and economies can be described in terms of their scope conditions. A polity with scope has more than one political party, more than one ideology, and more than one center of power. One instantly recognizes democracy in such a description. Multi-party competition, a diversity of opinions, judicial independence, a bicameral legislature, and checks and balances are features of democracy that meet our scope criterion. Within a democracy, scale-to-scope ratio can also vary across political organizations. For example, the modern Republican Party arguably boasts a substantially elevated scale-to-scope ratio in comparison to the Democratic Party. For me, categorizing political systems along their scale and scope dimensions, rather than by a simple binary divide between a democracy and an autocracy, is helpful. It recognizes that a democracy possesses scope conditions, but it may not monopolize them. This is a central issue I will explore, how Chinese autocracy has varied in its scope conditions. Autocratic scope is often hidden, a fundamental difference with a democracy. Scope conditions in a democracy are out there in the open, are legislated and specified. They are articulated and touted. Scope conditions in an autocracy are de facto, functional, informal, or occasionally delegated. They can be residues from an unfinished scaling project, and they manifest themselves as frictions in the system, as sands on a path of an autocrat. Autocratic scope, however, lacks permanence and irreversibility. It often hangs by a thread and is fragile. Scope can also describe an economy. An economy with multiple ownership types of actors is an economy with scope. An economy that only has one type of ownership, such as state ownership under central planning, is an economy without scope. An autarkic economy that closes itself off to international trade and capital has less scope than an open economy. The Chinese regimes of the dynastic and communist eras vacillated between open and closed economies, and therefore varied in their scope conditions. A moral from the Dazhishang uprising is the hazard posed by the heterogeneity of climate conditions, and how failing to take into account that heterogeneity can be disastrous. To the pre-modern rulers, scale and scope presented multiple challenges, and their interactions produced unanticipated complexities. Long distances increased communication costs, and rulers lacked timely and accurate information, hampering efficient decision-making. In the late Qing, when the Taiping rebels captured the city of Wuchang, about 1,200 kilometers away from Beijing, it took 8 days for the news to reach Beijing. The ability of the Chinese state to rule over a large territory and over a long span of time during an era without modern communication technologies is a non-trivial achievement. Ancient Europe was unable to do it. China, by contrast, reconstituted itself into a unified polity in 581 and has remained a cohesive political unit ever since. This accomplishment and its upside, as well as its downside, deserve our attention, appreciation, and explication. Democratic solution to the scope problem. The Size of Nations by Alberto Alesina and Enrico Spolaore is a modern formalization of deep-seated tensions long recognized by thinkers and philosophers from the eras of antiquity. Aristotle, Cicero, Machiavelli, Rousseau and Montesquieu maintained that republics were delicate flowers that could only be cultivated in small gardens. They all worried about the corrupting influences of increasing size and scope. Montesquieu believed that virtue, a quality that brought benefits greater than to oneself, was constantly threatened by 1,000 considerations, and that vastness and virtue necessarily contradict each other. At the Constitutional Convention of 1787, delegates noted the impressive size of the Spanish Empire, but also the imposing size of its despotism. It was James Madison who turned around the debate by redefining virtue. Diversity was a virtue, and the solution to the downside of the diversity was to spread factions, interests, and passions thin and wide, and to have them check and balance each other. A system of checks and balances, along with rule of law, free and fair elections, and an independent judiciary, is a democratic solution to the underlying tensions between scale and scope. Today, all large countries, except China, have some democratic components in their political system. Some, such as Russia, are electoral autocracies. This is an enduring strength of a functioning democracy. Its ability to scale while maintaining scope, whereas autocracies can only scale at the expense of scope. In ancient times, it was the other way around. According to Stasavage, early democracies were small, whereas there were sizable early autocracies. It is a miracle that large democracies, such as the United States and India, with their ethnic, religious, political, and socioeconomic heterogeneities, can exist as single political entities and can function and deliver economic growth and public services. Many ancient thinkers were pessimistic that large democracies would succeed. Take India. Winston Churchill once quipped that India is no more a united nation than the equator. Yet one need not take the words of Churchill at face value to agree with him about India. Churchill is known for his racist views on India. We can invoke an adage by a left-wing economist and humanitarian, Joan Robinson, to reach the same conclusion. As recounted by Amartya Sen, Robinson remarked, "The frustrating thing about India is that whatever you can rightly say about India, the opposite is also true." To be sure, Robinson got quite a few things wrong, in fact, spectacularly wrong, about Maoist China and North Korea. In a paper mapping the countries of the world by ethnic fractionalization and cultural diversity, India scores high among the major countries. Its cultural diversity score is 0.667, compared with a score of 0.154 for China. India has struggled mightily to balance scale and scope, often trading off scale to preserve scope. Its multiple languages, many ethnicities and religions, complex and immobile castes, and extreme variances in human capital, India has some of the world's best computer scientists, yet some of the world's worst primary school pupils, have impeded many important economic scaling projects. Take manufacturing production. Remarkably, for a country growing more than 6% a year between 2008 and 2017, a manufacturing share of GDP remained stubbornly stagnant at around 16 to 17%. A study shows that Indian manufacturing firms are undersized compared with those in other countries. Micro and small firms accounted for 84% of all manufacturing firms, as compared with 24.8% in China, 27.5% in Malaysia, and 69.6% in the Philippines. This is due either to the outsized vigor of Indian entrepreneurship or to the fact that Indian firms have trouble scaling to size. The latter is more likely to be closer to the truth. India has one incredibly effective scaling tool, elections. Indian electoral turnouts at the national level are high, sometimes more robust than those in the United States. By most accounts, Indian elections at the national level are free and fair. English is another scaling tool, at least among Indian elites. In recent years, under Prime Minister Narendra Modi, a man who pursues scale more avidly than India's past leaders, the Indian state has developed a suite of tools that will increase the scale-to-scope ratio. One of the most controversial efforts was to craft a common identity by attenuating the Muslim component of Indian identity. Not surprisingly, such moves have provoked protests and backlashes. In a scope-rich and scope-entrenched nation, homogenizing religious identity is a risky and counterproductive move. Prime Minister Modi has rolled out some technocratic tools whose immediate objectives are not to scale, but they are more promising in delivering a scaling effect down the road. The world's largest biometric ID project, Aadhaar, was made mandatory by Modi. It had been an opt-in project under the previous administration. Another consequential accomplishment under Modi is the Goods and Services Tax, or GST. The GST unified tax rates across regions and reduces double taxation on goods falling under different tax jurisdictions. GST will foster more internal trade and more regionally integrated supply chains. As Arvind Subramanian, an economic advisor to the Modi government, remarked about the GST in his 2018 memoir, "We should not forget the magnitude of the GST achievement. 30 or more regional governments coming together, giving up their sovereignty for the larger common good of creating one market in India, improving tax compliance, creating a robust revenue base for the country, and creating the fiscal environment for higher investment and growth." Similar mechanisms exist in the United States. The United States has incredible scope in terms of ethnicity and socioeconomic conditions, and in terms of diversity of opinions. To some, wearing masks is a commonsensical public health measure. To others, it is an instrument of oppression. Scientists blame global warming for the forest fires in California, but the same fires were also blamed on an inadequate sweeping of the forest ground, according to Donald Trump. One of the threads that such an opinion-rich nation can hang on to is the strength of its election system and its ancillary institutions, such as an independent court and media. This is why Donald Trump's challenging of the legitimacy of the 2020 election posed an existential threat to America's functioning as a nation and a democracy. For a democracy to scale while preserving its scope, it has to scale on the required dimensions and achieve homogeneity on them. It is critical to have a broad agreement in the society and a complete agreement among political elites on the sanctity of elections and the rule of law. One does not agree to disagree on these issues. One agrees to agree. To secure this agree-to-agree homogeneity, democracies have set up multiple mechanisms to ensure free and fair elections, including election observers, vote-counting transparency, court challenges, etc. These are all investments in the credibility of elections. Without this democratic consensus, a society is at risk of defaulting to autocracy or anarchy. The challenge for democracy is determining that minimum scale, enough to enable the political system to function, but not so much to trip over to an autocracy. Democracies can and do entertain a wide variety of views on religion, sexual orientation, climate change, preferences for political parties, and many other matters, the kind of heterogeneity that is unthinkable in an autocracy, and the kind of heterogeneity that often baffles visitors from autocratic countries who intuitively equate uniformity with scale. Democracies can afford plenty of room for scope, precisely because they are successful in homogenizing the idea and the norm of the democratic process. We can apply a similar perspective to academic democracy. Academia has rich scope, as anyone who has attended a seminar can attest. But that has not stopped the expansion of the modern research enterprise. Researchers congregate at large universities rather than being segregated at individually homogeneous small silos. Peer reviews and consensus formation, which all academics subscribe to, resolve conflicting opinions and conclusions on decisions such as promotion and tenure. Academia scales by a common methodology: knowledge in the public domain, deference to domain expertise, external reviews, and the ways to evaluate impact. Like democracy in the real world, academic democracy can be messy, sometimes acrimonious, and occasionally erroneous, but it is probably a better system than all the conceivable alternatives. Chinese autocracy: scale over scope. In the model developed by Alessina and Spolaore, citizens in large nations hold heterogeneous preferences, making it difficult to formulate consistent policies and programs. The referendum movements in Scotland and in Quebec suggest that Great Britain and Canada may operate at the edge of an invisible optimal zone between scale and scope. The preferences, cultures, and historical legacies may be too diverse to be accommodated under a single political framework. This is where autocracies and democracies sharply differ from each other. The autocrats in my book do not sit idly by, agonizing over and feverishly identifying ways to optimize scale and scope, and trying to strike an appropriate balance between the two. They undertake actions to directly crack down on differences of opinion and forcibly revise and induce changes in citizens' preferences. Think of the re-education camps during the Cultural Revolution, the national security law in Hong Kong, the metric-driven management system of the CCP, and the gathering dominance of Confucianist ideology that has emerged since the 6th century. All are designed to modify, attenuate, or eradicate existing heterogeneities of ideas and conduct. Autocrats proactively homogenize their countries, rather than taking heterogeneity as given. Their success depends on the development of effective homogenization tools. Imperial China, since the 6th century, and the CCP today have developed some very effective tools at their disposal. Unlike many other books, I do not focus on the substantive claims of Confucianism or communism. I take it for granted that Confucianism and communism brook no dissent among their followers, but their effectiveness requires implementation and implementation tools. A central point of this book is that Chinese autocracy is entrenched, deeply embedded, and enduring because it has developed an incredibly effective implementation mechanism. The first letter of the East formulation, civil service examination, and meritocracy, features centrally in my account of the invention, expansion, and maturation of that implementation tool in the hands of generations of Chinese autocrats. Chinese autocracy is lopsided on the scale side of the equation, even compared with other autocracies, with an impressive scale-to-scope ratio in their own right. Take Russia as a comparison. Russia is an illiberal democracy, and Vladimir Putin's regime is repressive. But it has richer scope conditions than China. During the run-up to Russia's invasion of Ukraine in February 2022, a survey conducted by Western researchers showed that only 8% of the Russian citizens supported sending troops to Ukraine. It is unimaginable that Western researchers could conduct similar unimpeded surveys in China, let alone on the eve of a major military operation. There are other examples. Google is banned in China, but it could operate in Russia, although under heavy censorship. The very fact that Vladimir Putin has poisoned so many of his critics is because he has so many critics who can speak out openly against him. Harassed and targeted by the state, opposition parties are still legal and tenuously legitimate. Some of Putin's critics command a sizable following. Contrast this with China. Since 2013, against the increasingly dictatorial Xi Jinping, there have been three prominent critics of Xi, and they were dispensed with quickly. Unlike Putin, who has to rely on extra-legal means to silence his critics, suggesting some formal constraints on him, Xi directed the full apparatus of the Chinese state to go after his critics. The Chinese court sentenced Ren Zhiqiang, a businessman, to 18 years in prison, and Tsinghua University promptly fired Professor Xu Jiangrun, a law professor who wrote an open letter criticizing Xi. On the eve of the CCP's 20th Party Congress, a man unfurled on a Beijing bridge a banner calling for removing Xi Jinping. He was quickly detained. Ren, Xi, or the man now known as the Bridge Man, had no formal political organizations behind them. There are more scope conditions under an illiberal democracy of Putin than exist during the most liberal moments of Chinese autocracy. The CCP is more authoritarian than even its communist brethren, the Soviet Union. Russia had a long tradition of an independent intelligentsia, a tradition that tenuously persisted into the Soviet era. There are many well-known Soviet dissidents, Andrei Sakharov, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, Nathan Sharansky, and countless others. Wikipedia used to have an entry, list of political dissidents, grouped by countries. Under China, 6 dissidents were listed, but under Russia-Soviet Union, there were 176 names. Omissions and classification methodologies may explain some of the differences between the two countries, but they are not likely to explain all of them. Chinese police told Hu Jia, a dissident, that there were only 200 people in the whole country who agreed with him. In the language adopted for this book, the Soviet Union had more intellectual scope than communist China. One reason could be ethnic. Many Soviet dissidents were Jewish, giving rise to the refusenik movement. This is a dimension entirely missing in the homogeneous China. In recent years, a de facto scope has emerged in China, giving hope to those who wish to see democracy and rule of law in China. This de facto scope is China's private sector, which now generates more than 60% of GDP and accounts for 80% of urban employment. But this de facto scope turns out to be no match for the absence of legislated scope. Xi Jinping has taken a series of actions to put the private sector in its place. Just a few days before the biggest initial public offering, or IPO, in history, the IPO of Ant Group, a fintech subsidiary of Alibaba, Xi canceled the scheduled stock debut. Jack Ma was often viewed by others, and he probably made the error of viewing himself as politically untouchable. Not so. The usual visible and outspoken Jack Ma then completely disappeared from public view. The East Formulation. A reasonable premise is that all Chinese autocrats want to impose homogeneity, but they vary in their capacity to do so. Autocracies may thus end up with some residual scope conditions on their hands, and some autocrats will face more frictions than others in the pursuit of their agenda. This is true in Chinese history as well as in China today. The question is, what scaling tools do autocrats employ? One simple method is killing the people who disagree with you. A joke from the Soviet era goes like this. On his deathbed, Lenin calls in Stalin and asks, "After you succeed me, are you sure other comrades will follow you?" "No problem," Stalin replies. "If they do not follow me, they will follow you." Qin Shi Huang, China's first emperor, the man who unified China in 221 BCE, famously buried many Confucian scholars. He adopted legalism as his ruling ideology, and he went after the root of his problem by killing the proponents of Confucianism. Joseph Stalin also killed many of his perceived political opponents during the Great Purge, as did Mao during the Cultural Revolution. But these were Pyrrhic victories for dictatorships, and even for the dictators themselves. Known for his cruelty and coercion, the Qin was a short dynasty, lasting a mere 14 years. The family name of Qin Shi Huang is Ying, a rarity in China today, which one account attributes to the genocide of the Ying clan after the demise of the Qin dynasty. Stalin purged and killed so many of his generals that when Hitler launched Operation Barbarossa, Stalin's army was caught initially unprepared. Nor did Mao fare well. Just several weeks after his death, his wife and his ideological followers were arrested, and his policies were cast aside by a man who, according to an urban legend, always sat himself at the Politburo meetings in such a way that his deaf ear would face the chairman, Deng Xiaoping. In Chinese history, the largest killing spree of political elites probably occurred under Zhu Yuanzhang, 1328 to 1398, the founding emperor of the Ming Dynasty. He killed over 100,000 of his own court officials and their associates. Similarly, during the Qing Dynasty, literary inquisitions killed an untold number of writers, poets, and scholar officials. My immediate reaction to these numbers is, the emperor had so many elites to kill. This was in pre-modern times. To kill 100,000 Ming bureaucrats and still have some leftover bureaucrats to run the country implies a massive bureaucracy in the first place. That is the first order of our explanatory business, the size of China's imperial bureaucracy. How did China manage to create such a large literate and literary managerial class hundreds of years before universal education? The CCP's surveillance project to scan faces requires an explanation of the country's ability to collect massive quantities of data and to integrate data across multiple domains. The Chinese autocracy has always been coercive and sometimes even toward its own elites. Coercion might have helped China homogenize its ideology on the margin by getting rid of elite dissent, but the main instrument to scale the bureaucracy and to rule a large and a growing territory with consistency and standardization was its ability to homogenize ideology. This is China's secret sauce and its scaling instrument. It is a non-trivial task to homogenize ideas and incentives of ruling elites. It requires design, purposefulness, and massive investments. This is where the examination component of my East analytical framework comes in. In this section, I will give a brief rundown of the East formulation in history and today, as well as offer a speculative idea about its future. Imperial China. The foundational institution of political China is Keju, the Imperial Civil Service Examination. Keju means subject recommendation, and it was instituted in 587 by the Sui Dynasty, 581 to 618, a pivotal dynasty in Chinese political development. Keju encapsulates an effect that Henry Kissinger posited, which I cited at the opening of the introduction. It maximized knowledge and reduced scope for action. The knowledge is a specific kind of knowledge: memorization, cognitive inclination, and a frame of reference all bound to an exceedingly narrow ideology known as Neo-Confucianism. Keju drilled this knowledge into the minds of a large swath of the Chinese male population over a millennium. The scope for other ideas disappeared. Keju homogenized Chinese human capital. Now, put yourself in the position of an autocrat in possession of this incredible tool. You will use it to enhance your capabilities, to maximize loyalty, and to design and calibrate human capital to monopolize and maintain power. Keju decimated society by denying it a vital nutrient, human capital. Through Keju, the imperial state crowded out everything else that would have stood in the way of an absolutist state. No independent intelligentsia emerged, despite high literacy. Think of the contrast with Russian autocracy here. Commerce was overshadowed. Organized religion never had a chance. All of these autocratic effects are on top of the deep cognitive biases in favor of autocratic values incubated by Keju. The most powerful state is one without a society. By society, I mean organized society. Imperial China and its CCP successor qualifies as that state. Stability ensued in the aftermath of the autocratic entrenchment. This is in part because the powerful imperial bureaucracy marginalized the aristocracy and landed gentry. It is also because the Keju system successfully diffused one vulnerability that afflicts all autocracies: opposition from elite insiders. After the 6th century, China experienced fewer and fewer elite rebellions and almost no unconstitutional seizures of power. China was trapped in a splendid political homeostasis. In this book, I will make frequent references comparing Imperial China with Europe. In the realm of technology, the comparisons and contrast are especially fitting. If we have to credit our modern world to one thing, it is the failure of historical Europe to scale itself. The polycentrism of fragmented Europe in the aftermath of the Roman Empire ceded ideological and political modernity and unleashed technology and economic growth. Keju scaled China and created an antipode to post-Roman Europe. Political and territorial competition collapsed. Ideological space contracted. China's exalted technological lead dwindled, forfeiting the optionality of its own industrial revolution. China fell behind. The CCP era. According to the website Our World in Data, China is the only autocracy with more than 100 million in population. Large countries find it easier to accept rather than eviscerate a given level of heterogeneities. The CCP has opted for a different approach. At 1.4 billion in population and over a diverse economy and society, the CCP still insists on homogenizing ideas, values, and conduct. The CCP has been stable in that it has been successful in self-preservation. In recent years, Unlike Imperial China, the CCP has delivered on stability and technological development simultaneously. Partisans of this system, including the CCP itself, but also foreigners who have pontificated on the subject, describe it as a meritocracy. Meritocracy is the most natural point of connection between the CCP and imperial bureaucracy. Meritocracy is a controversial concept, and listeners will naturally read into the term the various connotations that are implied and embedded. To avoid any confusion, let me explain how I use the term in this book. I will use meritocracy to mean that it is a metric-driven system. Unlike the partisans of this system, I make no claims about the meritoriousness of the metrics and their welfare impact. It can produce good outcomes, such as GDP growth, for the most part. Alternatively, it can pursue population controls to an extent that harms the welfare of the Chinese citizens and prospects of the Chinese economy. Or it can banish a fixed proportion of Chinese intellectuals to the labor camps as rightists. The CCP system is beset with many problems, such as corruption, inequality, power struggles, human rights violations, and policy hubris of immense proportions. This is not at all an immaculate system. That said, the autocracy of the CCP is a far more sophisticated and productive organization than that blueprinted by Keju. More than the imperial system, the reformist CCP recognizes the severe constraints on its ability to monitor the functionaries of the system, and it leans heavily on incentive alignment to induce the desired outcome and conduct. For the purpose of this book, I define the reformist era as from 1978 to 2018, with 2018 being the year that the presidential term limit was abolished. Compared with the imperial system, the reformist CCP is less absolutist in ideological alignment. Economic growth is weighted heavily in the metric-driven assessment, even though it requires scope expansions, for example, endorsing private ownership, foreign capital, limited autonomy to civil society, research collaborations with the West, and substantial freedom of action on the part of the bureaucratic functionaries. The CCP has never let go of the economy and society, but it has delegated a lot of autonomy to them. This amount of delegated scope, I argue, contributed to the economic and technological achievements under the reformist CCP. The reformist CCP has delivered the paired accomplishments of both technology and stability. There is built-in stability, which is due in large part to the cognitive legacies of Keju, pro-autocratic values and deference to authority, and the bequeathal from history of a society-free polity. There is also stability that is managed, and this is one area where the CCP is guaranteed to underperform against the imperial state, transition of power from one leader to another. Imperial successions were rule-based, male primogeniture. By contrast, CCP's successions are open-ended. Succession conflicts have plagued the CCP throughout its history, but so far, they have not escalated into a systemic breakdown. This is either due to fortuitous circumstances or to the institutional guardrails that the reformist CCP has put in, such as term limits. But things changed under Xi Jinping. Future of the East Model. All Chinese leaders are unabashed autocrats, but during the reform era since 1978, some of them have faced more frictions and constraints, often emanating from their own peers. The watershed political movement was the 1989 Tiananmen crackdown. The CCP gradually moved toward the scale end of the spectrum, and under Xi Jinping, it has accelerated the pace. The CCP in 2023 is a frictionless autocracy, an autocracy without any significant scope conditions. Between 1978 and 2018, the CCP manufactured a rare feat of delivering on both growth and stability. Chinese history swings between the extreme ends of these two accomplishments. The Hansui interregnum, 220 to 581, excelled at technology, but it was riven with conflicts and disunity. The Qing dynasty had the opposite combination. Its stability was stellar, but the dynasty marked the nadir of Chinese technological development. The Tang might have landed inside that optimal zone. It enjoyed political longevity and some technological accomplishments, although on technology, the Tang paled in comparison with the previous eras, when China was less unified politically. During the contemporary era, the reformist CCP got the balance right more often than not. But the CCP under Xi is tipping China again toward extreme scale. The zero-COVID lockdowns, which ignore the science and the changing circumstances surrounding the virus mutations, are an apt illustration of this development. The CCP is an autocracy, and it has a built-in gravitational pull toward homogeneity. The corridor is narrow to get the balance right, to borrow from Acemoglu and Robinson. The CCP under Xi Jinping has reverted to China's long-run autocratic mean, and it did so at its most confident moment. It emerged from the initial COVID-19 pandemic relatively unscathed compared with the richer and technologically advanced democracies. The chaos that marred the transition of power from Donald Trump to Joe Biden was taken to confirm a long-standing view of the CCP and of the ordinary Chinese, that autocracy is conducive to stability. Amplifying this view of the CCP is the narrative of China as an AI superpower and as a full-spectrum competitor in the Western discourse on Chinese technological dominance, further boosting CCP's priors about itself. In 2021, Xi Jinping proclaimed that the East is rising and the West is declining, his vision of a new world order. Xi has turned the Chinese autocracy into a prescriptive model. To the CCP, the rising East is all about scale, and the declining West is all about scope. A careful review of evidence marshaled in this book directly contradicts this perspective. The lesson from Chinese ancient and recent history is clear. A country needs to strike an optimal balance between scale and scope to get things right. The Qin dynasty literally destroyed itself by getting the balance wrong. The Sui squandered China's technological lead by eviscerating its scope conditions. By decimating the myriad heterogeneities of the reform era, Xi is repeating the mistakes of prior eras and is damaging China's economy and technology. There is a looming threat on the horizon to one component of CCP stability, leadership succession. In this area, the CCP is completely on its own, and it cannot draw from the repository of know-how, ideas, and methods from hereditary imperial China. During the reform era, the succession stability held because of the term limits. In 2018, Xi rescinded term limits. We will only appreciate the full impact of this action when a future succession is resolved in their absence. I believe that China is entering into one of its most uncertain and perilous periods. I do not have a crystal ball, but a reasonable conjecture is that the East formulation as configured during the reformist era of the CCP may be on the verge of breaking down in one way or another. China may retrench further to extreme and potentially militaristic autocracy by getting rid of all or a substantial amount of de facto scope, such as private sector, foreign capital, and economic decentralization. Or it may break away from the current East formulation by recognizing, legislating, and expanding its extant scope. The East formula is no longer a stable equilibrium. Outline of the book. This book is broad and ambitious, spanning both historical times and the present day. Historians may object to my sweeping treatment, and social scientists may take issue with the topical expansiveness of my approach. These are legitimate criticisms. My defense is threefold. One is that my topical expansiveness is bounded by the scale and scope framework. The four components of the East formulation are analyzed through the prism of these two opposing forces, rather than being treated as unconnected topics. There is a thread that ties otherwise disparate topics together, and I leave to the listeners to judge how successfully I tie the thread. The second defense is that my invocations of history are mainly meant to shed light on the present times. I am making a relatively uncontroversial point that today's China is rooted in its past. That may sound obvious, but going beyond this broad statement and identifying specific connective tissues and sinews between history and the contemporary era is not as obvious. For me, it is the exam-based meritocracy that transmits the autocratic genes across Chinese political eras, although I recognize that there can be other channels of connections. Finally, it is not so much a defense but a plea for forbearance. Scholarship on China is famous for its orientation toward details and rich narratives. In addition to that, literature with a bit of reductionism is unlikely to be too ruinous. The apportionment of my treatment is unbalanced between history and the contemporary era. My historical account covers some 2,000 years of Chinese history, whereas my contemporary account focuses on the period since 1978. The only justification is that I will touch on a few really salient features of the Chinese history and do it with the aid of data. Chinese history is a vast topic, and I am writing this book with a decisive disadvantage of not being a historian. My purpose, however, is not to uncover new historical knowledge, but rather to construct and infer patterns from history at a high level. Doing so is more feasible now as historical data have become available, supplementing the rich stock of knowledge that historians have created. My historical narration draws heavily from newly created databases on historical technology and on imperial politics. In the past 6 years, I have overseen two major data construction projects. One is a comprehensive database on Chinese inventions in history. The other is a database on a variety of attributes of Chinese emperors and senior court officials. Using data to analyze history allows us to get away from what I label as a 2Q problem in Chinese historical research. Social science research tends to focus on the bookends of Chinese dynastic history, either the Qin or the Qing. With data, we can delve into the dynasties in between. We may lose some textual and narrative granularities, but hopefully we can gain from a more holistic view of China's historical trajectory. I also want to write this book for a general audience. Although the ideas and the empirical findings are based on and distilled from my work and the work of others, my writing style does not always follow a rigid academic format. China is no longer an exclusive domain of China scholars. The policy toward and the perception of China are increasingly shaped by discussions and discourses that are tangentially rooted in knowledge about the country. I hope my book can contribute to the richness and informativeness of these public discussions and perspectives. The book is meant to be broad, rather than focused on one or two themes, as is the usual style for academic books. It draws from history, but also eclectically from economics, political science, and psychology. Where appropriate, the book offers conjectures, speculations, and normative ruminations while fully acknowledging things we do not know and complexities that defy simple linear projections. I draw policy implications in the book. For the policy community in China, I hope they are open to the idea that too much autocratic stability is detrimental, and that this conclusion is not based on Western values and ideology, but on China's own history. While there are unique Chinese characteristics, China's technological development and its broader economic takeoff are a product of an optimal combination of scale and scope conditions. This is not a perspective one often hears in official accounts of Chinese development. Scope contraction moves, such as curtailing China's private sector or undermining the autonomy of Hong Kong, are economically and possibly politically damaging. For the policy community in the United States, I point out flawed assumptions of a policy approach known as engagement, and I propose an approach that may have a better chance of nudging China toward more political openness. Finally, I hope to provide some food for thought to anyone who is willing to ponder an alternative political future for China. Many academic books shy away from a normative orientation. We seek to explain and make sense of the world we observe, rather than imagining or advocating a world we want to see. In case there arises an inflection moment for China to contemplate an alternative future for the Chinese political system, I hope that some of the ideas I propose here can be helpful. For now, I will engage in it as a thought experiment and not give much consideration to its utility. The book has 5 parts, and in the first 4 empirical parts, the content is roughly split between history and the PRC. After this introduction, 2 chapters in part 1 deal with the E component of the East formulation. One is devoted to Keju, the other is devoted to the organizational architecture of the CCP. In part 2, 1 chapter shows how the imperial autocracy was entrenched by Keju, and another chapter traces the evolution of autocracy during the reform era and shows how the 1989 Tiananmen crackdown laid down the path to Xi Jinping. Part 3 analyzes the stability of regimes during the 2 eras. Imperial China attained stability, measured in the length of the emperor's rule, as it scaled its bureaucracy. During the reform era, the CCP has maintained an impressive record of regime stability and has benefited by tapping into traditions, norms, and practices from history. There is, however, one prominent exception: leadership succession. In this area, the CCP has had to improvise. The track record of the CCP in peaceful transfers of power is not encouraging, and the direction that Xi Jinping is taking the CCP is worrisome. Part 4 tackles technology. 1 chapter in this part grapples with the Needham question, the famous puzzle posed by Joseph Needham as to why Chinese technology collapsed. The other chapter argues that the technological advances under the CCP result from an adroit collaboration of China's scale advantage, what I label Republic of Government, with the West's scope advantage, which is known as Republic of Science. Part 5 opens with a chapter on Xi Jinping. The previous chapters on the PRC era are mainly focused on the period leading up to Xi. The transformative impact of Xi is reverberating in China and globally. The final chapter is an assessment of the future of the East model. There is a lot we do not know, and the track record of China analysts making predictions about the future is not stellar. Knowing the minefield in front of me, I approach this topic with humility and caution. Part 1. Examination. Chapter 1. Keju as a scaling instrument. Nowadays, I personally preside over the exam and decide who can pass the exam. This can completely eliminate the ills of the old system. Song Taizong, 2nd Emperor of the Song Dynasty. The Imperial Examination Museum in Nanjing offers a glimpse into what it must have been like to take a Keju examination during the Ming Dynasty, 1368 to 1644. Nanjing was the capital of the Ming during its early years. The museum is a replica of the Jiangnan Examination Hall built for the provincial exam, the first of the 3 Keju tests. The venue is massive, covering an area of some 300,000 square meters, making it larger than Gillette Stadium, home of the New England Patriots football team. Inside, there are 20,000 examination rooms, with each room designed to hold 1 Keju candidate. The provincial exam, administered by the Central Imperial Court, was held in each of the 14 provincial capitals. The replica of Jiangnan Examination Hall depicts both the grandeur of the Keju exam and the utter misery it caused. During the exam, the 20,000 candidates were forbidden from leaving the site, each crammed in a cell that was only 4 feet long and 3 feet wide. What's more, the exam was held during the hottest month of the year, in August, in the oppressive and humid climate of Nanjing, known as one of China's three big furnaces. Out of this experience of misery, Keju scaled imperial bureaucracy, but as a scaling instrument, it itself had to be scaled first. In this chapter, I will trace its history, and in that telling, I will feature three autocrats who played a starring role. There are some fascinating details about them, including the fact that two of them are known, and the third is rumored, not to have adhered to an ideology that came to serve as the operating software of the Keju hardware, Confucianism. They were disruptors in some ways, but they also entrenched China's political system in other ways. The history of Keju is a long and complicated story. In brief, there were two milestones of this remarkable institution. One is that Keju became progressively more systematized over time. By the 11th century, Keju had acquired a degree of formality that American college entrance exams lacked as late as the 19th century. The other is that Keju evolved from scope to scale, sacrificing diversity in order to attain scale. That evolution is also the evolution of China's political system writ large, and it is in that sense that Keju anchored political China. The rise of meritocracy. The Keju system was hugely influential, not only in China during ancient times, but also across Asia and into the modern era. It was emulated by neighboring Asian countries, such as Vietnam from 1075 to 1919, Korea from 958 to 1894, and, to a lesser extent, Japan from the 8th to 12th centuries. Keju also provided a blueprint for the meritocratic systems in the West, first in Prussia, and then in Britain and the United States. Today, China's college entrance examination, the Gaokao, is closely modeled after Keju. As far as I know, no one has yet offered a compelling explanation for why an examination approach, as opposed to other assessment techniques, featured so early and so centrally in Chinese statecraft. Perhaps the examinations had what psychologists call an imprinting effect. The learning and internalization acquired during a critical early stage of cognitive development. The examination, as an idea, methodology, and practice, shaped the formation, development, and maturation of the Chinese state. A brief history. The Keju exams screened human capital and recruited it into the ranks of the imperial state. To understand this basic function of Keju, we must first review the other methods that the imperial system employed to perform these same functions. There were two. The most primordial mechanism was the family, that is, using bloodline as the pipeline, or, as an extension, drawing recruits from nobility. It is here that China sharply diverged from the West. Other than hereditary successions to the dragon throne, the Chinese had long steered clear of running the country on the basis of bloodlines, in principle if not always in practice. The rise of Keju dealt a fatal blow to the nobility and aristocracy as the supply base of political human capital. The other mechanism was a reliance on elite judgment, recommendations from the heads of local governments or regional aristocracies. Keju undermined this mechanism as well. Although the Qin dynasty had launched a first salvo against the power and legitimacy of governance by nobility, local aristocracies managed to survive this initial assault. They then experienced a revival during the Han dynasty, the successor to the Qin, which crumbled as a result. Up until the Sui dynasty, powerful regional families had remained entrenched and strong. Starting in the Sui dynasty, Keju examinations came to gradually eclipse the recommendation route, although they did not displace it instantaneously. Between the Sui and the Ming, the pool of examinees was widened, and male commoners began to gain entry into the imperial civil service. Keju was open only to the male population. This dilution effect did not happen organically and spontaneously. Rather, it was deliberate and designed from the top. The curriculum became standardized, and the imperial court provided the necessary resources for administration and enforcement. Such formalization and systematization then produced secondary, and for the imperial court, first-order, political effects. They strengthened the imperial autocracy and narrowed the ideological space in China. The Sui dynasty drew from an extraordinarily rich Chinese tradition that favored assessments based on constructed metrics, known in the modern era as key performance indicators. An examination is an ancient Chinese idea. There are references to exams in classical texts as early as the Zhou period, 1027 to 221 BCE. If such references are to be believed, the practice of examinations predates the creation of the Chinese polity. There is documented evidence of exam practices during the Han Dynasty. The Han had a sequential arrangement, whereby candidates for central government service were first recommended by the heads of local prefectures, then were examined by central ministers. The formal name for the recruitment system under the Han was Cha Ji, or observation and recommendation. First, the emperor would issue employment notices. Then, officials from all levels of government would make recommendations. The desired criteria for candidates were vague, such as filial piety and integrity. The recommendations were followed by oral exams, much like interviews by company recruiters after they have reviewed resumes. The purpose was to solicit the opinions of the candidates rather than test them on their technical skills. These oral examinations were followed by another round of recommendations, from the ministers to the emperor. This was a labor-intensive process, and, in all likelihood, the evaluation process was subjective. Although the examinations were but a minor element in the system for selecting officials, in the opinion of Qian Mu, a prominent historian, one onerous objective standard had to be met. Those wishing to obtain clerical positions in government were required to take literacy tests. The hurdle was high, a mastery of 9,000 characters. For comparison, according to a 1988 standard promulgated by the Chinese State Council, literacy for a rural Chinese person is defined as the ability to read 1,500 characters, and for an urban resident, the ability to read 2,000 characters. The Han Dynasty invested heavily in the cultivation of its political elites. In 124 BCE, under Emperor Han Wudi, an imperial university was established to teach the Confucian classics. It taught a professional education rather than a foundational education, similar to the central party school today. The imperial university had 50 to 100 students by 80 BCE, then 200 students by about 60 BCE, and 3,000 students by 10 BCE. According to Guinness World Records, the oldest university in the world is the University of Keruing, founded in 859 in Morocco. China beat that record easily. Contrast this Chinese fixation with the literary type of human capital with the Roman Empire's obsession with promoting generals who climbed to the top by their feats on the battlefield. Throughout Chinese history, the military has been relegated to a station inferior to that of scholar officials. For whatever reason, Chinese rulers have long privileged mental capabilities over physical prowess among those whom they wanted to recruit into leadership positions. Physical capabilities are directly observable and can be assessed in the real world, on battlegrounds or in a coliseum. Assessing mental capabilities, by contrast, requires constructed metrics. That was the idea of an exam, and it is a remarkable idea. Chinese purposely eschewed outcomes in the real world as the basis for making personnel decisions. Constructing metrics was a costly and design-intensive endeavor. Rules and protocols needed to be devised to ensure that selections would lead to the desired attributes and to safeguard the informational value and sanctity of these metrics. It was a leap of faith that performances on these constructed metrics were predictive of the desired real-world outcomes. In some ways, this process-oriented thinking is similar to the faith that we have in democracy and rule of law. If we take care to set up the process correctly, good things will happen. During a period between Han and Sui, when China fell into disunity, 220 to 581, the examinations were discontinued, and the recommendations became the only basis for making appointment and promotion decisions. This period, which I will call Han Sui Interregnum, features prominently in the history of technology. Not coincidentally, during this period, there was a resurgence of rule by local nobility. A system known as the Nine Grade Referees arose to replace the observation and recommendation process. The referees, who were further divided into senior and junior referees, evaluated the candidates in their respective regions according to a registration form devised by the reigning emperors of the kingdoms. The registration form classified the evaluation criteria into 9 categories. The referees would complete these forms, then submit the evaluations to the superior bureaus for further consideration. No formal examination was involved. During the Northern Song Dynasty, 960 to 1127, Keju acquired and developed its famous features, a triennial schedule comprised of 3 tournament tiers, a preparatory channel, and, possibly, anonymization. During the initial years, the exam was held irregularly, and sometimes not at all. During the Tang Dynasty, 618 to 907, it was only one of several recruitment channels for the imperial bureaucracy. But by the Song, Keju was beginning to crowd out other mobility channels. On a per capita basis, Keju reached its apex during the Song, when it was the recruitment vehicle for about 90% of ministerial positions, compared to a range of 50 to 70% during the Ming. Some 200 Jinxi degrees, the highest degree possible, were granted in every Keju round. Candidates with humble backgrounds began to populate the Keju candidacy. In the late Tang, 76.4% of those who passed Keju were from noble families, but this percentage dropped to only 12.8% during the Northern Song, marking the dawn of China's meritocratic age. The rising importance of Keju was accompanied and enabled by its systematization. In 1067, an imperial decree set Keju on its triennial schedule. Protocols and processes were established to ensure the integrity and accessibility of the Keju platform. During the Song, the curriculum for Keju was still quite open-ended, but then it was standardized, and the format became defined and scripted. The multi-channel system of the Tang began to give way to the single-channel system of the Song. During the Yuan Dynasty, 1270 to 1368, Keju encountered some headwinds. Officials initially suspended it, and although it was reinstated in 1315 by Ayurbarwada, the Yuan's fourth emperor, the scheduling became irregular, and recruitment from Keju was restricted to lower-level positions. The Yuan rulers, however, implemented a consequential change. They adopted specific annotations from the Confucian classics as the Keju curriculum. These annotations were based on Neo-Confucianism, an interpretation of the Confucian classics attributed to Song-era philosopher Zhu Xi. One of the greatest Chinese philosophers, Zhu Xi was a nuanced thinker, but his streamlined version of Neo-Confucianism, adopted and adapted for the Keju curriculum, was textually tight, deeply conservative, expositionally homogeneous, and narratively unambiguous. Interpretations of the four books and five classics were no longer at the discretion of the Keju candidates. Instead, the instructions were preset and pre-programmed. Neo-Confucianism is more unabashedly autocratic and statist than original Confucianism. It exalted eliminating human desires and a complete subjugation of the self. Summarizing a common view among historians, Peter Bull observes that Neo-Confucianism provided a justification for seeking external authority in the ruler, and stipulated that the emperor alone was responsible for transforming the world. Remarkably, Neo-Confucianism extricated morality from consideration, instead advocating absolute and unqualified subordination to the ruler, however idiotic or amoral he might be, according to sinologist Arthur Wright. Wright further asserted that the new Confucianism was more totalitarian in intent than the old had been, in that it gave the monarch authority to police all private as well as public morals and customs, to extirpate heresy. This political rigidity spilled over into the social arena. Women were completely subjugated, with widows, for example, forbidden to remarry. The idea was that fidelity to her husband should endure beyond his lifetime. Foot-binding of women was introduced. No wonder the Mongols embraced Neo-Confucianism.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.